church at Laodicea. It was founded in the 3rd century B.C., the city that is, by Antiochus II, and it was named in honor of his wife, Laodicea. It was on a plateau between two small rivers, and thus water had to be piped in from hot springs from the area, and it arrived lukewarm. We will have more to say possibly about that idea in a little bit. But it was also the center of Asian travel routes, and thus it was assured of commercial success. It was a city of great wealth. In fact, one of the wealthiest cities in the world at that time. Bankers, exchangers, we would say millionaires and billionaires live there. It had a medical school that manufactured a special type of ointment as a balm for the diseased, afflicted eyes. It became a clothing center, fashion center, early on because of a type of cloth that came from the black wool of sheep that were grown there. In AD 60, one of the other speakers mentioned the earthquakes that took place in that region. Well, in AD 60, there was a major one. And while Rome helped other cities rebuild and offered Laodicea money to do so, they refused to accept any money from Rome and rebuilt the city themselves. See if you can find some of that in the United States today. Its citizens, though, as is so often times the case with wealth and that we see that we're talking about of this kind, had become complacent, self-reliant. And unfortunately, these types of attitudes spilled over into the Laodicean church. We don't really have any mention of the origin of the congregation, although Epaphras might have been the one who founded it, as the only other times in which it is mentioned is the book of Colossians, chapter 2 and verse 1, and then in the 4th chapter, verse 13, and then verse 15 and verse 16. So that gives us a little bit of background. The speaker identifies himself, first addressing it to the angel of the church there. But the speaker deals with his messianic attributes to a certain extent. He is the Amen. One of the great things that we can see in relationship to that, and I won't spend time trying to develop it this morning, is the fact that what he says can be relied upon. Now, our salvation is dependent upon his reliability. What if he said, repent, be baptized to be saved. And then at the judgment he says, I'm going to change the rules now. Those individuals who were baptized, well, too bad, you're going to be excluded. See, our salvation is dependent upon his reliability. That's what Jesus is saying. I'm reliable. What I say is true. He's the faithful and true witness in that he testifies of God and his nature so that when we see Jesus, we see the Father. And he is faithful in that everything that he witnesses concerning God is, again, reliable. It is true. It's trustworthy. And he is the beginning of the creation of God. Now, this does not mean, as some try to pervert this, that he is the first thing that was created. The Word has to deal with originating source. He is the originating source of the creation. He's the cause of it. Everything that was created by him. John, the 1st chapter. Then he goes into the Laodiceans' work. Jesus knew their work. Many of the other speakers have spoken about the idea of Jesus' knowledge of our works, so I'm not going to repeat what they have already stated. But he knows our works as well. In this congregation, there is nothing that is said that is a statement of approval, commendation. What a sad commentary upon a once faithful congregation. That now then, nothing that Jesus says about it is good. We know that Jesus judges in righteousness, Acts 17, verse 31. And yet, when he sees this congregation, nothing is good. When Jesus sees us, congregations that we are a member of, what will he say about us? Will it be commendation or condemnation? It's going to be a righteous judgment, whatever it is. But then we get into the condemnation. They were lukewarm in their religious attitudes and activities. They were like those lukewarm waters that I mentioned just a moment ago that were coming into the city. They were neither hot nor cold. But when you see that a congregation that is not guilty of some great evil, they weren't involved in wickedness and sin that we would consider. They were not teaching false doctrines, as some of the congregations that Christ addressed here were involved in. They were not involved in ungodly fellowship practices. There's really nothing major that you could say that is wrong with this congregation. Except lukewarmness. A listless, unconcerned, indifferent, heartless type of religion. They had become self-satisfied, even as the effects of the city had filtered over into the church. A city that was self-satisfied because of the riches, now then, they are self-satisfied. They had more of a, I don't really care attitude. And Jesus says, I would that you were hot or cold. The idea of hot, of course, is a fervent, the idea of boiling even, a fervent faith, being a zealous, on fire for the Lord. Or he says cold, and the idea of cold there is icy cold. No link at all with Christ. Now, when we see Jesus saying, I would that you were hot, we can understand that. I mean, as members of the church, we have no difficulty why Jesus would say to a lukewarm congregation, you need to be hot. So we don't really need to spend a lot of time with that, but why cold? I would rather you be cold, that is no link at all with Christ, than to be lukewarm. The person and congregation who is lukewarm brings a reflection upon Christ and his cause because he is a lukewarm pretender. The cold person is in reality more honest than the lukewarm member. Jesus said in Matthew the 12th chapter and verse 30 that he that is not with me is against me. Here's a group that's saying we're trying to be in the middle. We're trying to ride the fence of lukewarmness, not really being for Christ, but not really being against him either. We don't want to be known as being against the people who are against Christ, he's saying, are more honest than these individuals who are trying to take a middle-of-the-road stance. Now, we could understand if that lukewarmness was a short transitional stage to being hot. But that's not the case with the church at Laodicea, and it's not the case with many congregations today. Instead, the church at Laodicea was in an abiding state of lukewarmness. And as a result, it was fatal to them. It's normally considered as a safe state. And that's one of the great problems of it. I think of all of the problems that we see in the book of Revelation and with congregations even today, the problem of lukewarmness is possibly, maybe I should even say probably, the most difficult problem to combat. I can see, to use an illustration, as David and I were talking about it this morning, and he used this illustration. I thought it's so good I'd incorporate it, David, so I'll give you credit for it. That here's the Apostle Peter, let's say on a Sunday morning, he preaches a fine gospel sermon on lying. And here's Ananias and Sapphira. They've already decided what they are going to do, that they're going to lie to God, the Holy Spirit. And at the end of that sermon on lying, they go out, they shake Peter's hand. Boy, that was a great sermon, Brother Peter. You really hit old Brother Dub there. He really needed that. You know, it goes right over their head when they are the ones who are guilty of the lying. There's certain individuals, and probably every preacher has experienced this. You set up a lesson, you know that there's someone in the congregation that's going to be there that you know needs to hear that. You preach your heart out in relationship to that, and what happens? Well, that sure was a great sermon. No, so-and-so really needed that. How many of you have not experienced it? That's lukewarmness. That's the attitude that we're seeing in relationship to Laodicea. And that's why it's so difficult to combat. I think with some individuals, the lukewarm attitude has so overtaken them that you could get up in the pulpit and say, Bruce, I'm talking to you now, you need to listen, and then say it. And some of our brethren would just say, boy, that was great, and never realize I was talking to them. Because they are so overwhelmed with lukewarmness, they cannot understand their true spiritual condition. And so lukewarmness robs us of the ability to give the proper attention to the problems that we have from a spiritual standpoint. Because people very simply will not see it and will not make the proper application. But lukewarmness is a state of neutrality. Now, it's like Israel of old. Here's Israel, and they want to hold on to Yahweh, and they want to hold on to Baal also. And Elijah comes along and challenges the prophets of Baal, and then he turns to the people and asks, how long halt ye between two opinions? See, I want it to be, they were lukewarm. They wanted to hold on to both. They weren't on fire for God, but they weren't on fire for Baal either. And so Elijah tells them, if the Lord be God, follow him. If Baal is God, then follow him. Make a decision. Lukewarm people, though, like they were. Well, it says that the people answered him not a word. And that's a lot like members of the church today who are lukewarm. They cannot see their true spiritual condition. In preaching this at home, I use the illustration of my wife was given a counterfeit $20 bill. Now, if that counterfeit $20 bill had Lester Camp's picture on it, I imagine she would have thrown it away and rejected it real quick. See all of y'all nodding your heads with me on that. Because it would be so far out that there's no connection with the authentic. But it didn't have anything like that. It was made close to the original and thus became more dangerous because the person handed it to her, she took it, and then tried to buy something with it, and they said, this is false, this is a counterfeit $20 bill. She took it and, yeah, it is. You see, lukewarmness is like that counterfeit $20 bill. It makes it appear as if everything's right, but in reality, it's fake and it's worthlessness. Far too many congregations today within the Lord's church, far too many Christians have gone into simply a lukewarm state. I think there's an interesting point that Jameson, Fawcett, and Brown make in their commentary in relationship, and this more deals with my previous lesson Friday night on one congregation withdrawing from another, but it says, they state that it is remarkable that the Greek adjectives are in the masculine, agreeing with the angel, not feminine, agreeing with the church. A lot of people, when mentioning the other lessons, who will state, well, one congregation cannot withdraw from another because there might be some individuals in that congregation who have not apostatized. They were withdrawing from a congregation, just as the Lord here was dealing with the church at Laodicea, yet he uses masculine adjectives instead of feminine adjectives. He's dealing with the leadership that in a congregation, the elders, the preacher, those individuals who would be leading the congregation in that way. And so, yes, there might be some that were not lukewarm, but that's the tenor of the congregation because of the leadership. And so in withdrawing fellowship from another congregation, you're withdrawing from that congregation because of the leadership of that congregation and thus the tenor of that congregation and what it is now. Even though there might be some who have not spoiled their garments yet. If they stay in that sinful situation and start compromising, they will have, though. I thought it was an important point that I saw in noticing this congregation. The church at Laodicea claimed that they were rich, increased with goods, have need of nothing. There are some who look at these comments about themselves and say that these are things from a spiritual standpoint that they were thinking. That they thought they were rich, spiritually speaking. That they were increased with goods, spiritually speaking. That they had need of nothing spiritually. And that might be the case, but I don't really believe that. I think he's dealing with it from a physical standpoint. They were rich materially. How much difficulty do we see in the United States because of riches within the United States? I think it was Brother Brewer who mentioned the fact that, you know, we are a rich nation. And that richness causes and makes an inroad into the attitudes of the Lord's church so that we have that attitude of self-sufficiency. How many going out to teach the gospel to a lost and dying world, we face the problem of people who don't need a thing, including God, because they feel like they're self-sufficient. That's the congregation at Laodicea. They were self-sufficient. They didn't think they needed anything. Those types of attitudes will never allow one to come to Christ. No wonder. Christ said, for where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Matthew 16 and verse 21. And Luke, the 12th chapter, he told us to beware of covetousness. And then he tells us, a man's life consisteth not in the abundance of things which he possesseth. Now, why the emphasis there? If that attitude will not cause someone to become self-sufficient and thus lukewarm, even within the Lord's church. So while their appraisal is, we're rich, we're increased with goods, we have need of nothing, you also need to look at Jesus' view of them. You're wretched. That idea is one who's pitiful, distressed. He's in an afflicted condition. So, wretched, miserable. This is one who is totally void of real heavenly hope. He is full, or one to be pitied. He's full of misery. One lexicon says that the word means deserving of sympathy for one's pathetic condition. That's Jesus' appraisal. Wretched, miserable, poor. Idea of the word poor here is one who has been reduced to a state of begging and thus total dependency upon others for support. But here it is a spiritual poverty, utter helplessness. They are completely destitute. Their worldly property and their worldly goods could not meet the wants of the soul. They are blind. And again, this is spiritually blind. It's a figurative term that is used for someone who is unable to understand. Someone who's ignorant. Just like the illustration that we were using a while ago of someone, you know, you call their name even, they're not going to understand. They're blind. They were naked. Salvation is often referred to as a garment within the scriptures. These were without the spiritual garments of holiness, righteousness, sobriety, godliness, all of those spiritual characteristics and attributes that we as Christians are to possess. That's their spiritual condition. Lenski stated that these five adjectives with the one article present five aspects of one and the same condition. And then he added, worst of all, these people who are in this condition do not know their state but boast of being rich. If you ask the lukewarm member of the Lord's church today, their spiritual condition, why, I'm saved. I'm in a right relationship with God. And yet they're lukewarm. How do we know sometimes? Well, we've been having a lectureship starting Friday night. Were you here? What is your spiritual condition? Think you can just sit out and ignore preaching of the gospel? I've been edified by being here and hearing all of the great lessons. You cheated yourself out of such? You don't need it? You think you're rich? You think you're increased with goods and you have need of nothing and you do not realize your true spiritual condition? You come on Sunday morning, Sunday afternoon, well, you know, I miss that. Or Wednesday night, you know, I'm way too busy or I need my rest. And we make excuses, but where's our true spiritual priorities? Now, Jesus' appraisal was the right appraisal, but it was a stark contrast to what they thought they were. They thought they were a huge success, a great working, happy, growing congregation. They were great in their own eyes, and possibly even from some outsider's eyes, they were a great congregation. But we need to start judging righteously. Make right judgments. We must, as Paul encouraged individuals, to examine yourselves whether you be in the faith. Prove your own selves. but it's not based upon our standard. It's not based upon others' standard. It has to be upon the standard of God's Word. And whether then making an honest appraisal of our lives and our actions. The curse then, their lukewarmness was sickening to Jesus. Jesus threatens to literally vomit them out of his mouth. Go through this New Testament. See if you see any sin that is dealt with in all of the scriptures, really, that produces such a reaction to God. Now we know that those who apostatize are like those who the dog who returns to his own vomit, but that's them. This is Christ saying, "You make me sick at my stomach. I'm going to vomit you out of my mouth." But there's hope. I will. It implies the possibility of the threat not being executed. If they repent, that action will not take place. So the stipulations: buy gold from Christ, a gold purified in fire, thus a pure gold, something that does not have any impurities in it. It's true spiritual wealth that Jesus is talking about here. And this, while the physical riches would not make them spiritually rich, this will give them true riches. This is true spiritual wealth. The Laodiceans boasted of a great wealth, but it was a counterfeit wealth. It could not bring peace. It could not bring happiness or joy. It could not bring purpose in life. It could not bring health of body, mind, soul. It could not bring comfort in times of sorrow. It could not bring fellowship in times of loneliness. All of those things money can't buy, and riches cannot buy. But here's true spiritual wealth. And wear white robes or raiment, white clothes. These are garments that God provides. The righteousness of saints that is spoken of in Revelation 19 and verse 7 through 9 comes by the faith, Philippians 3 and verse 9. And it comes when we put on Christ, Galatians 6, 27 and 20, or 26 and 27. And it is so their spiritual nakedness will be covered. Nakedness has always been presented from the time of the first sin as something to be ashamed of. Even though our society today does not recognize nakedness as being a shame, it is. Fine raiment, on the other hand, was a great honor. So many times to honor someone, they would come and put fine raiment upon him. We need to recognize from a physical standpoint, nakedness is sin, and know what nakedness is. When you start uncovering from the shoulders to the knees, then you become naked, and it should be spoken to your shame. But so many times we glorify it today. Well, this is spiritually clothed. Put salve on your eyes so that they can have true vision, clear vision. Again, here's Laodicea, known for their medical practices, specifically relating to the eyes, to enable people to see clearly. We need to be able to see ourselves clearly, see ourselves for what we truly are. That takes clear vision. To examine ourselves, as Paul set forth there in 2 Corinthians 13:5, we have to look at ourselves. And we have to look at ourselves honestly. And not with, as the old statement, rose-colored eyes or tinted colored glasses. See ourselves for what we really are. Are we that lukewarm Christian now? Have we allowed our complacency to set in so that we're no longer being what God wants us to be? as individuals and as congregation. He tells them, be zealous. Zealousness would certainly be the opposite of being cold, but it's also the opposite of lukewarmness. These individuals at Laodicea were lukewarm, and he's saying you need to be zealous. You need to get out of that soul-damning lethargy that you are a part of now, that you've allowed to set in within your lives. You need to see yourself clearly to realize your miserable, wicked condition. And yet, this is the condition that is probably the hardest for an individual to see, because he is self-deceived into thinking that he's in a right relationship with God and everything's all right and hunky-dory. Be zealous. The word zealous there is in the Greek is in the present tense, mean you continue to be zealous. The problem is many times, and that's true with all of us, we become a member of the Lord's church, and many times there's a zeal that's involved there. But over the years and decades that we are members of the Lord's church, we allow that fire that was within us to start going out and dimming, and we become lukewarm. Oh yes, we still attend all of the services of the church. We're still going to make sure that truth is being taught. We don't want any error, and we don't want to be involved in any error. We're going to fellowship, but we still don't have that fire that burns within us to be zealous. And that's a danger of every member of the Lord's church as we go through and live our Christian life. So be zealous. Continue to be zealous. Always have that fire within you. And repent. Repent is in the aorist tense, and it's an imperative. A change of mind. You have a complete change of mind regarding your spiritual condition. From being lukewarm, and now then you be zealous, and you continue to be zealous. You see, there's the change of mind that results in an amended life. And then Christ says that there's a door there, and he encourages them to open the door while he's knocking at it. They had rejected Christ by their lukewarmness, yet he's still there at the door, knocking at the door, encouraging them to open the door for him. The knocking at the door expresses his effort through God's word, the scriptures, to be admitted into their hearts. But in order to do that, they're going to have to hear his voice. They have to abide within the doctrine of Christ, 2 John verse 9. If we continue in his words, then we're his disciples. And the truth shall make us free, John 8, verse 31 and 32. It also shows us that they are the ones who excluded Christ, and they are the only ones who can allow him back in. He will not force himself into our hearts. We have to open the door for him. Calvinism, on the other hand, teaches that God forces himself. But the scriptures show that we are the ones who make the choice. Joshua told the people of old, choose you this day whom you will serve. We have to choose to serve Christ. We have to choose to be on fire for him. And no one, however much they wish, no one can make that decision for me. No one can make that decision for you. I may want to, you may want to for me, but nobody can do it for me. I have to do it myself. Salvation is an individual matter. But Christ will always be there ready to enter into our hearts if we will but allow him. He is taking the initiative in seeking sinful man. But there's a time coming when that knocking will cease. When death comes upon us, or at that second coming of Christ, that knocking will cease. And that opportunity to allow Christ into our hearts will have ended. And our eternity will be sealed. What will it be for you and for me?